We begin today with a demonstration of the weaving of a dream catcher to show you how it is done. This demonstration is on a large scale so that you can see the construction of it. Traditionally, the dream catcher is only 3 to 5 inches across. Today, dream catchers are made by Native American artists from many nations. There are many Native American stories and legends about spiders and webs and the legend of the dream catcher, but the Ojibwe, called Chippewa by others, originated the dream catcher. After taking a look at the long tradition of storytelling, oral histories passed down from parent to child, generation after generation, this clears up any confusion about the origin of the dream catchers. The legend says that long ago in the ancient world of the Ojibwe nation, the clans were all located in one general area of that place known as Turtle Island. The people were being tormented by nightmares. The elders and medicine people all tried to solve this problem on their own, but not a one made progress against the dreams. So a council for all the people was called. During this council, one elder had a vision of a spider's web in a hoop with a feather and bead attached that would catch the bad dreams while letting the good dreams pass through. This is the way that the old storytellers say how Spider Woman helped the Great Spirit bring back the sun to the people. To this, Spider Woman will build her special lodge before dawn. If you are awake at dawn, as you should be, look for her lodge and you will see this miracle of how she captured the sunrise as the light sparkles on the dew which is gathered there. Spider Woman took care of her children, the people of the land, and she continues to do so to this day. When the Ojibwe nation dispersed to the four corners of North America to fill a prophecy, Spider Woman had a difficult time making her journey to all those cradle boards, so the mothers, sisters, and grandmothers took up the practice of weaving the magical webs for the new babies using willow hoops and sinew or cordage made from plants. The dream catcher is in the shape of a circle to represent how the sun travels each day across the sky. The dream catcher will filter out all of the bad dreams and allow only good dreams to enter into our minds when we are asleep. You will see a small hole in the center of each dream catcher where the good dreams may come through the web and slide down the feather to the sleeper below. The bad dreams get caught in the webbing, and with the first rays of sunlight, the bad dreams will melt away and perish. When you see the little Spider Woman, you should not fear her, but instead respect and protect her. In honor of her origin, the number of points where the web is connected to the hoop numbers 8 for Spider Woman's 8 legs, or 7 for the 7 prophecies or grandfathers. Some dream catchers may have 13 for the 13 moons or even 28 for the lunar month. It was traditional to put a feather in the center of the dream catcher. It means breath or air. It is essential for life. A baby watching the air playing with the feather on her cradle board was entertained while also being given a lesson on the importance of good air. This lesson comes forward in the way that the feather of the owl is kept for wisdom, a woman's feather, and the eagle feather is kept for courage, a man's feather. This is not to say that the use of each is restricted by gender, but to use the feather, each is aware of the gender properties she or he is invoking. Indian people in general are very specific about gender roles and identity. The use of gemstones, as we use in the dream catchers made today, is not something that was done by the old ones. Government laws have forbidden the use of feathers from our sacred birds. So using four gemstones to represent the four directions, and the stones used by Western nations were substituted. The woven dream catchers of adults do not use feathers. Dream catchers are made of willow, preferably red willow, and sinew are for children, and they are not meant to last. Eventually, the willow dries out and the tension of the sinew collapses the dream catcher. That's supposed to happen. It shows us the temporariness of youth. Adults should use dream catchers of woven fiber, which is made up to reflect their adult dreams. The traditional dream catchers are only 3 to 5 inches across.
You know, Hawkwoman was talking about Spider Woman. Native Americans had a very close relationship with nature. Plants and animals, they knew the plants that would save life. They knew the plants that would kill. They knew whenever they killed an animal, they thanked the animal for giving its life so that they could live. And they used every bit of it. Nothing was wasted. Later on, we're going to show you some of the things that are made from animals. But the Native Americans considered the animals their brothers, and they never would harm one needlessly, nor would they ever kill one just for fun. They killed them for food and clothing, and survival. They used the skins of the animals for their clothing and to make their shelters. They used the bones for sewing needles. They used the sinew for thread. And they used the meat for food. A delicacy among Native Americans was intestines. They would clean out the intestines and they would stuff them with meat and boil them in water. And they liked to eat the liver raw. They considered that it gave them strength. They would take blood and they would stuff the intestines with the blood and they would boil it until it was done and slice it up and they would eat that. And they considered that a delicacy. They would dry their meat and they'd serve it with fat. They would dry the meat and they would use that, and the meat that they dried, they called jerky, would last for years. And sometimes it tastes like it's been there for years. Now, we're gonna do what is called an intertribal dance. And this is a dance where everybody dances. And we would like to invite some of you, if you would like to come out here and dance.
Jay, go!
Come on. I ain't going for it.
Thank you.
You know, Native Americans' concept of the land was quite different from white men. They didn't know the concept of owning land. So when the white men asked them to sell them their land, they didn't know what they were talking about, because they called the land Mother Earth, and they couldn't conceive of selling their mother. And so it was very easy for the white man to take the Indians' land away from them, because it would be like you winning a Monopoly game from a child. You could tell them whatever rules you want it to be, and they don't know any different. And that's the way the Native Americans were. They didn't know any different. So taking their land away was very easy. And the Native Americans were very friendly to the white men when they first began to encroach on their land. But only when they were pushed to the wall did they begin to fight. They saw the buffalo dying all around them. They saw their land being taken away, and they were pushed to a smaller and smaller and smaller area. Finally, the white man told them that they would have to live on reservations, and that they would feed them, and they would provide their clothing. But what they provided was rotten meat and smallpox-infested blankets. Thousands and thousands of Indians died because the white men deliberately gave them blankets infected with disease. And more than that, whenever they began to intermingle with white people, they had no immunities to their diseases. And so they died from measles, whooping cough, mumps, chicken pox. What is amazing is that any Native Americans survived. But they got smarter as the years went along, and they did survive. Now this next dance that we're going to do is called a gourd dance. And only men are allowed to hold the gourds during the gourd dance. But the women can accompany them with fans. And this is not a dance where everyone dances around in a circle. This is, Pauline here is Comanche. This is the main dance of the Comanche people. Her stepfather visited us last summer, and he's a famous Comanche dancer and a member of the Comanche War Society. And he told us that the gourd dance can sometimes last all night long. That they can do the gourd dance and never even realize that they're dancing all night long. It's so powerful to them. So the next dance that we're going to do is called a gourd dance.
Thank you.
Started by men who would, and young boys usually, who would get out and dance and stomp down the grass to make a big area for dancing. There's jingle dancers. These are girls who have usually about 365 jingles sewn onto their dresses. When they dance, the dresses jingle. The jingles are usually made from small metal cones. And the legend of the jingle dress is that a little girl's grandfather was very sick. And a vision told her that if she made this dress, if she put a jingle on every day for 365 days or 1 year, and prayed over it, that at the end of that year she could do a dance and her grandfather would get well. And she did. And her grandfather got well. And that is the legend of the jingle dance. There are women shawl dancers, which is a very beautiful thing to see, and we have a shawl dancer in our group, but she's in the middle school, and she'd be counted absent if she was here today, and so she's not. But the women got jealous of the men because they got to do all these fancy dances, like the grass dance is very flashy, very fancy. And they wanted to do something like that, and they started dressing up as grass dancers and pretending to be men. And so they decided that if they were going to continue to do this, they needed to dance of their own, and that's where the shawl dance came from, and it's a very beautiful dance to see. They have different types of traditional dancers. They have men's northern traditional, men's southern traditional, women's northern traditional, women's Southern and Northern tradition, and what do you see us do here today's women's tradition? None of us are limber enough to fly around out there and do the shawl dance. The shawl dance, they call them butterfly dancers lots of times because they look like butterflies when they're out there doing their dance. Each tribe had its own dance, types of dances, but now you'll see all those intermingled when you go to a powwow because the people get together now. Used to, they didn't. Tribes stayed to themselves, but now then they're all intermingled, and so you'll see the different types of dancing. And you'll see men and women dancing together unless it is a contest dance. Now then, I'm going to ask Spirit Seeker to come and tell you a story. This is a Native American story.
You know where a rattlesnake is? Huh? Well, I got a story to tell you. It's about a young man, about the age of 10, 11, maybe 12 years old. The young man then is called a buck. Before he can become a brave, he must venture to the highest mountain he can find. Now he would spend 3 to 4 days there. So he picks this young man, wants to become a warrior, to the grave before he becomes a warrior. So he leaves his family and journeys on out to the highest mountain he can find. He goes up there and he stays. The first day, he gets ready. After that day, a big snake crawls out, cold and freezes. He says, "Please, take me to the valley below so I may get warm." He says, "I cannot do that. I must stay 3 days." So the snake went away. Next day, coming, the snake reappeared again. He went through the same thing. He says, "I cannot. I'm going to stay another day." So the next, finally, the third morning appeared, the snake showed again. He said, "Please, please, I'm freezing. Take me to the valley below where I can warm and live and eat good." He says, "I cannot." So on the fourth morning, he makes the preparations to leave to go home because he has fulfilled, he has received his vision. That's what Indians call visions, we call also dreams. And he received his vision to become a young brave. When preparation made ready to leave, the snake shows again. He says, "Please take me to the valley below so I may warm and eat and do good." And since his young last day, the boy young man says, "I will." So he picks the snake up, pulls his sleeve up, wraps it around his arm, and pulls the sleeve back down again. And takes the snake down to the valley. Whenever he sees the valley, it's nice and warm, he takes it off, picks the snake, puts it down. Since he did that, the snake hit him. Snake bit him, he struck and hit him. He says, "But you said you wouldn't bite me." He says, "Oh, but you knew what I was when you picked me up." And the young man died before he could reach home from the snake bite or rattler. The regular version, that is the Indian version of telling how a man died from 2 bites of a snake. The version of today, the American version that we go now, is dope. I'm not pushing anybody to tell them how to do what they do, to make up your own mind on things like that. The dope, whatever it takes to take, and the needle is like a snake bite. It will kill you in the end. And live a long and happy life, don't let that snake bite you. Thank you.
This is our drum. The name, we're very lucky to have this drum. The name of our drum is Spirit Talker. And the drum is the heartbeat of the people. It's the heartbeat of Mother Earth. To us, the drum is very sacred. Mother Earth speaks to us through the voice of the drum. And at any Native American gathering, you will find the drum. And the people are always very, very reverent to a drum. Thank you.
30 minutes.
We have here some examples of Native American crafts. This is coyote head. It's worn as a headdress. This is a dream catcher. You'll see different styles of dream catchers. Everyone makes dream catchers their own way. This is an arm shield. The men wear this on their arms. It was a war shield, protect against arrows and spears. This is an example of Native American pottery. This is natural clay. And I don't know if you can see from where you are how they've used the different colors of the clay to make the design. You can see the pink, white, yellow, all different colors in here. This piece was made by the Comanche Potteries. This is a smaller bowl. Designers cut inside of this. Later on, we'll give you all the opportunity to come around and look at these things. This is a painted gourd. It's drawn in the shape of an otter. This is Evening Star's favorite animal, is the otter. She identifies with the otter. This is a pair of Comanche child beaded moccasins. Unless you've ever tried to do this, you can't imagine the amount of work that went into this. This is a war lance, and this was given the spirit seeker at a powwow in Shepherdsville for his Vietnam service as a warrior. This is Pauline Comanche leg. Pauline is dressed in traditional Comanche regalia. You can see right here, there's a piece that goes down the side of this that stops short of reaching the end at the bottom. That's traditional Comanche. Her belt, which I am not allowed to touch because it was made by and blessed by her grandfather, and she is the only one that can touch it, but she can explain to you what the different things are.
They was going everywhere, they had these pouches on the side of them. This is to hold their parry knife, their little small knife that they had. This little pouch right here is for their needles, their sinew, their thread, anything small enough to fit in there. And this one is where they, like a puncher, where they punch holes in the leather, in the rawhide.
And you can see her, you call this apron? This is her apron. This was made by her mother. This is a rosette.
a beaded rosette attached to bead necklace with bone, and these are shells at the bottom here. She has the same thing on her headdress here, the beaded rosette with the beads and the shells. And a lot of work went into this outfit, and these are all gifts to Colleen from her family. So you think how much love went into that. This eagle fluff, girls usually get this when they reach puberty. This is a signal that they are now a woman. This is an example of the buckskin dress. This is buckskin, trimmed with pony beads, bone, and leather thongs. Cricket is the only one in our group that has a buckskin dress, and she's very lucky. This is a traditional type of dress. You can see the tiered skirt, and with these you can pair almost any kind of top as long as it's not real flashy, shiny looking, or a halter top. You can see this is a beaded necklace here with matching earrings. Medicine bag. And she has a conch belt. And her little purse here, you can see the beads on this, medicine wheel. And every bit of regalia that you see Native Americans wearing these days, they have to make themselves because you cannot buy it. Unless you go to a powwow and you have about $1,000. Oh, this is a quilled medicine wheel, Marsha tells me. Do you know what quills? Quills came from porcupines. The Native Americans used porcupine quills for embroidery work. Lanny is dressed in buckskin. This is the breastplate. These are for warriors. His medicine bag. Choker is made from bone and a bear claw. This is a piece of deer horn right here. This is deer horn. They cut in pieces like this to use for jewelry and buttons. He has bells on his leg. Lots of men like to dance with bells because they make noise and they keep the rhythm going. Also, they're very inspiring to other dancers. And it helps ward off evil, Spirit Warrior tells me. Now this is the Cherokee regalia. The headdress, the shirt, the pants, the belt. It's a woven belt. These are, this is the way Cherokees traditionally dress. At this time, I'd like to allow you all the opportunity to ask questions. Does anybody have any questions? About anything that we've said or done today? Or haven't done?
Here's my hair. Go ahead. Are there any wild buffalo left?
Okay, the question was there any wild buffalo left? There's very few. They're out west. Most of them in the national parks. Any other questions? Do what? Those are not 100% buffalo. They're not. Yeah? You can go there to Kentucky Down Under and they sell the buffalo burgers and steaks and all kinds of stuff like that. Buffalo meat is really one of the best meat that you can eat. It's less calories and it's a lot better for you. At one time, back years and years ago, if you wanted to try to walk, and this is to give you an idea of how many buffalo there was, you could walk 10 miles on the back of your buffaloes. That's how many buffaloes there was. They would cover a 10-mile range, just completely covered. You could walk for 10 miles and never touch the ground for the buffaloes.
Are all of you all like Native American, like blooded or half? Or?
Every one of us, I believe, with the exception of me. As far as I know, I do not have any Native blood in me at all, but my husband is Cherokee. Everyone else in here, to some extent, yes, they do have a Native blood in them, and if you live here in the state of Kentucky, 9 times out of 10, each and every one of you has some degree of Native blood in you.
What y'all smoking your
pigs like? They smoke tobacco. It's unprocessed tobacco. You won't find any chemicals or anything in the tobacco. You smoke sage, natural herbs, different things like that.
Is that what they traditionally have in them?
Yes, sir. Yeah. In the peace pipe also, they smoke kinnikinick, and that's an all-natural herb. Okay, I want to ask, anybody else got any questions? Okay, I'm going to ask y'all a question, okay? Do you all know how to say hello in Cherokee?
No.
No.
How are you? How are you?
No. It's Osio. So when you see any Native Americans, most of them will say Osio. When they meet you, they'll say Osio. And do you know how to say goodbye? In Cherokee, it's do not bye, go hey.
What?
Do not go, go heavy. That's how you say goodbye in Cherokee.
Y'all want to know how to say thank you in Cherokee? Wadu. Chela G. Chela G means Cherokee. In Cherokee talk, Chela G. That's what I am. Chela G. I'm a Cherokee.
What about Peyote?
We don't use peyote. Peyote is used in some ceremonies in the West, but in this area we don't use peyote. Peyote is considered a very sacred thing. It's not a recreational drug and it's not used as a recreational drug. It's used strictly as a ceremonial thing. And the Native Americans that use peyote, there will only be one or two that are designated to be able to use it. And they are very revered people, and they are very respected, and they are very respectful to their ceremony.
I hate you.
Native Americans are just like everyone else. They have their own personal likes and dislikes. John Wayne happens to be a very favorite person with my husband, but I can take him to leave. And I don't like Charlton Heston, but a lot of the rest of the people do.
Why don't you like Charlton Heston?
Because he's president of the NRA, and I don't like the NRA. But that's my own personal thing. That's not something that I would try to impose on anyone else.
I love the NRA.
Not that I don't like Charlton Heston. I love Charlton Heston as an actor, but I don't like some of his viewpoints.
Harold's got a question.
Where?
Go ahead, Harold. Do all
y'all
live in
D.C.?
Sure.
Do all y'all live
in D.C.? I beg your pardon?
Do all y'all live in
D.C.? Of course not. How many TPs have you seen in this area? You know, all Indians do not live in teepees. A lot of people that go to the Sundance and the encampments like that, they take their teepees and set them up in camping. But most of them live in houses just like we do. I live in a house here in Edmonson County. And it was the women's job to transport the teepees, take them down and put them back up. Men didn't have anything to do with them. And the teepees belonged to the women. If they broke up, the women were allowed to set the men's belongings outside the door of the teepee, and they could take them and go somewhere else.
Yeah.
I watch somehow like all the old movies and come back. Like the Western Indians and the Scout movies. In newer movies they say that the white man started it. Is that true?
The first Indian scout was scouted by a French man because they found out the hair of the Indian was long. The longer the hair, the more money they got for it when they sent it back to England and France to make wigs for the big pompadours, the kings and queens and princes like that over there. If your hair was long like mine, probably about $50. We'd be selling some more to make it a wig. Yes. Yeah, I'm a Korean and Vietnam veteran though. Served 2 years. I was there because I had to go. I enjoyed it because I had to go to this guy. More questions? Yes. No, Geronimo Catahanechiwa, Geronimo was not there. Geronimo's name was given him by the Mexicans, that's what they called him because of what he was. Mexicans killed his wife and children. And he kept them, he worked on them and run them and killed many of them in place of that. He led a large army, U.S. cavalry army, giving them the run for their life, and all he had was 30 warriors. And he fought off hundreds of thousands of the American war, American servicemen. U.S. cavalry many years ago, back down in Arizona, and Mexico, and through Texas. He is a full of Apache, and we're proud of his heritage.
We're going to do a dance now that's a little more active than the ones we have been doing, and we need your help. And this time we get to choose. Everybody choose 2 people.
Thank you.
cousin who stuffs his own potato.
Hey! Hard. Let's go.